Good morning, everybody, and welcome to PGL Tower and Tales Spring Season. My name is Nimsh, and I'm here with Lotha and Raven. We're starting day two right now, top 16. But first, Raven, Lotha, how are you guys doing?
Yeah, Lotha, do that. Yeah, I'm good as well. I'm good as well. I don't have an intro like as good as that, but I'm good.
All right. Excited for day two, top 16. A lot of people got eliminated. Actually, half of them out of the 32 that qualified in the really grueling Swiss part of the tournament.
Well, no, it wasn't that grueling, right? It was only 5 rounds, so it's not like the whole day of playing like 12 rounds of Swiss.
But it's more than you play in an average tournament.
Well, that's for sure true, and I'm really liking that PGL is using Swiss as the second stage of the tournament after the qualification tournaments online. It's really cool to see, and then players having basically two chances, right, to get through to the second day, and half of them made it. That's the math. Basically, half of the 32 Swiss players will be advancing to day two. So now we have it, and Thijs was undefeated during day one, and now he will be facing the, well, least fortunate, I would say, player after the Swiss portion, because it's how it works is that the first player after the Swiss portion will be paired against the 16th, second against the 15th, and so on.
Yeah, we can see it on screen right now. Raven, who do you think is a surprise coming into this top 16?
Yeah, it's a tough one, actually. I think the biggest surprise is who isn't there. So, for example, we saw like Gara didn't make it, and Tars, which I think a lot of people were expecting to get through from yesterday. But overall, the top 16 looked really good to me. It's a really good mix. As Lothar said, we have Thijs, you know, huge name. We have players like Crane, Powder, Game King, Freaky, who are all, you know, well-known players. But as well as, you know, a lot of players that we've not heard too much about yet. So, yeah, I'm just liking the mix overall. It's going to be a really good day.
Absolutely. And the Swiss part, so Lothar, you touched upon it, but can you explain again, how does it work? I think in our hearts, some people are not that accustomed to Swiss overall.
Swiss is basically taken from chess, and it's a system which promotes variance and pairing players of a similar results, right? So how it works is that the first round is random, and players are being paired by a random generator, but then after that, players are being paired by their wins. So a winning player is playing against other winning players. So in example, in a 32-person Swiss, there will be only one person that will have a 5-0 result. Which of course, there's a second, there's the other end of the stick, which is some guy or some girl will have a 0-5 record, because that's how math works. And yeah, and that's basically it.
All right, that was a good explanation. And let's talk about the bracket as well, because right now the Swiss part has ended, the 5 rounds has ended, and we are coming into the single elimination round of 16. So something that's really common for Hearthstone. And this is where players actually change their decks, Raven. Do you think they will stay with the same lineups?
Yeah, it's a real tough one, actually. I managed to speak to just a few of the players before we started today, and even they were a bit like, I'm not sure either way, because you can look at who they know who they're playing today. You know, they knew that last night, obviously, because we announced it. And there was halfway between, do I want to actually cater my decks versus what these players were playing yesterday, or am I just happy with what I've got? So it's a real tough decision. I think we might see a lot of maybe like one deck change, but I'd be very surprised if we saw like a whole new lineup from anyone. It's much more likely to see just a few card altercations or just some like one deck out of the lineup altered.
Absolutely. And we can see the matchups for today. All the matches will be streamed. Players change their decks, and they will continue playing the last Hero Standing format without the ban. Lothar, do you like the format, or would you prefer Conquest?
I like Hero Standing, last Hero Standing in general. I don't know how to feel about the ban in current state of the game, because it promotes, well, Druid heavily. And as you can see, as you could have seen in our stats yesterday, 24 out of 32 players were bringing Druid to this tournament. So we had some classes that were overrepresented, and some classes that were basically non-existent.
Yeah, not presented at all.
Yeah, like Hunter. And it wasn't Shaman.
Yeah. It was a Hunter. Yeah, it was a Hunter.
Yeah, so there was no Hunters at the tournament. When you think about it, it's kind of crazy, right? 32 people are showing up at an event, and each of those are bringing 3 decks. So 3 different classes each, and none of them are picking Hunter. That means that the class, well, it's not doing well in current metagame.
Yeah, I agree. But even though there was the lack of Hunter and a lot of Druids, we did see a lot of interesting decks yesterday. The Freeze Mage from Crane with a bit more burst that really worked in the first match, 3-0. We've seen a lot of Reno Locks. We've seen a Priest and Aggro Shaman as well with Dr. Boom and Zoo with Sea Giants. So a lot of, different ideas about the decks that we've known before. And it was interesting to see them them being matched up.
Yeah, and we also saw Lothar's Mill Rogue, which was really interesting.
We did.
Too bad my preparations and vanishes were in the last 6 card.
But yeah, I think the representation is really interesting. I think at the moment, as you know, most players will agree, Druid's in a very strong position. So it's not, you know, too much of a surprise. We see a lot of Druid and a lot of Paladin as well. So yeah, a bit of a surprise at like 0 Hunter in that only 2 Shaman. That's an interesting one. But overall, I think it looks pretty much as expected.
It can change today because players could have changed their decks for this part of the tournament specifically. And yesterday we discussed there are 2 ways. You can prepare for the whole top 16 and just change your lineup and surprise others. Or you can just prepare for your opponent specifically to maybe win and advance to top 8. All of those players will only play 1 match today. And if they win, they advance to top 8. And they will actually double their money. They are guaranteed, like all of them are guaranteed 500 USD at the moment. If they win, they are guaranteed 1,000 at least and 2 HCD points.
Well, that's true, but I hope that some players will take learn the lesson from the last Bucharest tournament, which was won by two events ago when Stan Sivka won the event by exactly doing what the rules were allowing him to do, so preparing for each single matchup, and this is the case this the tournament too, because they can change decks after each single round, so. You know, if they can prepare against the tournament player in that round and then switch it around, because they will get knowledge against the about their next opponent, they can take the advantage. They can take the few.
All right.
Okay.
So basically, they could have changed decks for top 16, and then for the top 8, they will be able to change it again. And when they play top 8, they will have to stay with the decks. But I do agree that they can prepare for this opponent today. And then they will have to have a new lineup for the top 8.
Yeah, I think as well, like, because it is just for this win, and it does, you know, double the money, but also get the entry into the points and get, you know, like, guarantee a top 8 finish overall. I think it's likely that we can see players do that. And then for tomorrow, if they get through, then they'll move on to maybe a more, like, standard just lineup just to, you know, try and finish out the tournament as high as possible. Yeah,
absolutely. The first match that we are going to see is Thijs versus Lekkebouw. Thijs from Netherlands. We discussed Thijs a lot, the European champion. Lekkebouw from Greece, a very good player as well. We actually had some time to talk with the players and prepared a short video for you guys.
I'm Thijs Molendijk, known as ThijsNL from the Netherlands, 21 years old and playing for G2.
I'm like a boss. I'm 20 years old. I'm living in Berlin, but I come from Greece. I recently got engaged with my girlfriend and we had a little baby, Amelia, so I'm actually playing for her here and for all the Greek people.
What attracted me was just the experience I had already with the PGL, the series that I had in Bucharest before, at DreamHack against Gara, where I won in the finals. That was already amazing. And yeah, just I played the open qualifier, and I also liked playing an open tournament, having a Swiss tournament, and yeah, I'm really happy to be here. That's pretty awesome.
I actually like this event. It's one of the best every year. So I wanted to qualify. I owe this to one of my teammates, Pulmaniac. He actually helped me more than enough to get me here. So I have to win it for him also.
I don't have specific players that I would say that really surprised me. To be honest, I don't know everybody here, but I saw some also interesting lineups. People really take their own strategy, and that is what I like the most also about these open tournaments. You have a lot of players that play the decks I expected, but there are also really interesting strategies involved, and that is what I really like, that you just see a lot of their own stuff.
Outside, I thought Crane, it would be actually the best player here. And it actually proved me that he's the best player because I faced him and I lost 3-0 and 3-1. But I didn't expect the deck that he was bringing. His freeze mage was actually insane and he won me. And he proved me that he's actually one of the best players in the tournament.
Thijs versus Like a Boss. They are ready, they have their decks prepared. And Thijs went 5-0 for the Swiss, undefeated. The game we saw on the stream was also 3-0, right?
Yeah.
With the Zoo deck.
It was 3-0, yes. Like a Boss
squeezed in as the 16th place, and right now he has to face Thijs. Do you guys think he's in the correct mindset, in the right mindset to defeat Thijs and move forward?
I think it's a problem for almost every single player that when you're coming against a person that has a flawless result in a Swiss portion, then you're kind of undermined. You're undermining your own position. But it kind of be changed when you're thinking about, like, you can change your lineup. If like a boss made a change to his lineup that can counter Thijs, an example, because Thijs will not change his lineup, because why would he,
yeah,
right? After a Swiss portion of being 5-0, there's no reason, I think, to change the strategy overall. Maybe some small changes, some small tweaks, but in general, I wouldn't change the lineup at all. But that can be advantage for like a boss. We'll see.
Yeah, and we see the predictions on screen, and really interesting game. We saw this yesterday where, if I'm honest, it was a lot closer than I imagined it to be, like 54% for Thijs to win.
Look at the Twitter. What?
Oh, and it's just changed for Twitter as well. So, you know, Like a Boss has definitely been represented on Twitter pretty well. But, yeah, I agree. It's definitely tough to, you know, you're against a 5-0 guy. And when you realize, again, just to reiterate what we were saying about Swiss earlier, every time you win, you actually are versus someone else who has the same score, mm-hmm, pretty much. So it's not like he's been playing against, you know, he 5-0'd everyone who lost all their games or anything, yeah, like that. Every single round, you're playing against someone who has matched your score. So 5-0 is pretty crazy. So Like a Boss definitely has his work cut out for him.
Absolutely. I think it's also about motivation. So Thijs is having fun, enjoying the event. He just went easily with the 5-0. Fully easy, but it seems like it was easy for him because he just didn't drop a single match. And when we've seen him, he didn't drop a game. But Like a Boss is playing for his daughter. Like, he has a daughter waiting for him. He really wanted to be here and show his skills. So he might be more hungry or motivated to win this match than Thijs, who's just going to do his best.
Yeah, I think the mindset as well is when you're in a position where you're up against such a sort of well-known and you know, insanely good player, you just think, actually, instead of thinking about, oh, you know, I'm probably going to lose or anything like that, you think, but what if I win? Like, taking a win is actually huge, and I would view it as you have everything to gain in that way. But we do see the matches just starting now, so it looks like Thijs is going to lock in the Patron Warrior versus Like a Boss's Zoo.
Seems like so, and in theory, that's a matchup that is skewing towards the warrior, if he gets the patron warriors on the grim patrons on the board and gets even a one whirlwind effect,
yeah,
because most of the creatures that are being played by Zoo have less than three attacks, so they can't really clean up the situation after seeing a few patrons. But at the same time, there are a lot of buffs in the Zoo deck, so this might be.
Yeah, you definitely need to manage it carefully as the warrior here, and I think a card like Deathspite, as in most matchups, is going to be super key to remove the slightly bigger minions like the Nerubians and maybe, you know, Dark Iron Dwarf or something like that, and clear up the smaller minions.
That's
like Sublotha.
Fire War Axe, the fact that Thijs was throwing away his whole hand, even though he had the World of Infect and Inner Rage, he just was looking for the Fire War Axe early to be able to counter the early aggression from the Zoo. Zoo is really dangerous for the warrior if it builds up many sticky minions that you can't deal with overall, and at some point even Whirlwind is useless. But if you methodically just kill everything that is on board with your weapons, you will be able to just stop the Zoo and do your own thing, which is patrons.
Yeah, and I think this is looking pretty nice. You can lock in the Fiery War Axe now to start clearing off the Voidwalker is going to go, and he can do something next turn. But he also has the Frothing Berserker for turn 3, which will probably be really good, just because it's like we saw yesterday a little bit, where Frothing Berserker was played, and that card needs answering, and Zoo doesn't want to have to answer something with 4 health this early in the game. If something like a Power Overwhelming comes out, which, you know, on demand there, we just see one an option for, from the Discover, from the Dart Peddler. Like, if you want to sync a Power of Roman into a 2-4, it really feels bad as the Zoo player. You don't really want to do that, but that's the kind of threat the Frothing Berserker poses.
What do you think about the Young Priestess, Lothar?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that most likely would likely the Young Priestess on board right now, because you are aware that in this matchup, the clock is against you, yep. And you want to be as fast as possible. Adding a minion on board that is kind of problematic, because it's only a 2-1 minion, but it requires the answer right now, right? Because if it stacks up, if you will clear the 2-2 minion instead of the 2-1, the weapons might be not enough to clear a minion afterwards, and that's very important. So Thais, well, he ignores actually the Priestess. Interesting.
Yeah, I think this might be because if the so on turn 4, there's not a lot that like a boss can play. The additional health will be too much of a problem because he has Deathbite next turn.
Actually, maybe makes sense because the Haunted Creeper get there's a chance the Haunted Creeper will get buffed, so it will not be killed, yeah. And it will not trigger the death rattle effect. So it will be still kind of useless because a one attack minion, it's not really something that is worrying the warrior, right?
So yeah, especially with Whirlwind. So like,
there's no Whirlwind right now.
Yeah.
In Tyson's hand.
Yeah, the thing about the one attack minions is you never want them on board when there's patrons that can come out, because that is just asking for it, where the patrons will just never end because they can just repetitively trade with those and keep generating more. This is kind of a tough one though, because if like the Argus came down then, for example, you'd have to trade everything in, so that'd be pointless. So it looks like the Dire Wolf's going to go in there and buff these guys up, because again, you just have to answer the Frothing Berserker. You just can't leave it on the board.
Yeah, but still, you're getting the spiders that are buffed at the moment, so if there's no Whirlwind effect, you should be fine on this board.
That's a good draw. That's a good draw, because usually when you will play the Death Spider on turn 4 instead of the minion, there might be a case of the Defender of Argus, right? And then stops basically the weapon from attacking next turn. It's just too good of a scenario to play the weapon right now. It just looks too good, right? Then probably will happen something that will kind of like I was just playing into the weapon too much. So it might text you that your opponent has a Defender of Argus, an example.
Yeah, but still, weapon there was definitely making sense. Just killing the wolf, not taking that damage. If you would just play Pilot Shredder, you would just lose it there. But still, Defender of Argus is protecting the spiders from the weapon, and Shredder will be a nice follow-up, unless he decides to go for Lothab.
But is it so bad that you give away the Shredder? Because your opponent would have to sacrifice 2-1-1 minions, right? Because they get buffed with the attack. Which is not that bad. You still spawn another minion that will most likely clear the wolf next turn, unless your opponent will use a, let's say, a Mortal Coil from Dark Peddler, but you have seen that there was a minion already, right?
Yeah. So I'm wondering whether you want to think about maybe even like slam on the 2-3 and then attack in to one of them and then put the ghoul down or something. Just to get some more cycle, because as you said, like the minions are a bit sort of awkward to deal with, whereas the slam would remove the slam plus weapon attack would remove 2.
You can still Shredder, slam and coin Shredder.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, the Shredder.
You
might,
play
might
the unstable ghoul before you attack, so you can battle rage this turn.
Yeah, with double battle rage, it makes sense.
Okay, it's going to clear off with the inner rage.
The Pilot Shredder played this turn.
Yeah, the draw for the inner rage there was pretty good, just to clear the board. Because that's all you need to do against Zoo. You just keep the board empty and they'll just never be able to kill you. And we see now that Sea Giant is not looking too great on 9 mana at the moment.
Yeah, tough to play it. So, like a boss, you can go for Bran, Imp Gang Boss, or just for Lothab here. If he goes for Abusive doesn't do much at the moment. Bran can work with Abusive later on, but at the moment, if you just slam him, Gangbus and Bran, you're just going to lose Bran.
Yeah, I mean, I think to play Bran on this turn is just to give the Shredder too much of a good trade. You definitely want to remove Bran off the board as quick as possible, and because of that, it's already with a minion being down that challenges him. I imagine like a boss will want to save Bran for something a little bit a little bit more impactful later on.
Yeah.
I don't even mind Lothab on this turn.
Yeah, but if you Lothab, you will not be able to tap. It's like awkward in mana. Lothab is a bit better though, because it doesn't die to Shredder and you block possible whirlwinds. Or
yeah, exactly. Because the other two minions, the Shredder just kills them and still survives, more importantly. So there's still that as a threat. So I like Lotheb just to try and lock out this Shredder here.
Well, with this, Dice can just play his own Lotheb and go for face.
Still lacking that whirlwind in hand, but it's fine. Like, your opponent will most likely trade with the Lotheb instead, because he knows that there are too many effects that will deal one damage to the remains of the Lotheb, so you will not gain that much by just trading here with the Pulse Shredder. You'll not get value. It's not like an arena that will get you this going for like the next turn.
Yeah, there was enough pushing for Giant, so I do agree with that.
No execute though. That's a problem.
I wonder how worth it would be to play the Abusive Sergeant that turn, just to put another minion on the board. I don't know, it's a tough one with Brand in hand.
I mean, just to have the minion?
Yeah, just to put the body on the board, that's all. Because if there's like an execute, then like, yeah, you just, you know, your board's empty again. Whereas, you know, even just having the 2-1, it's something that sort of needs to be dealt with.
I think he didn't want to do to play the Abusive Sergeant because if your opponent will have the execute, he most likely will activate it somehow, right? And the best way to activate it is to play a whirlwind.
Yeah, that's
or
true.
Or just clean up somehow the board, right? So this is the turn when Tice will start be the aggressor. So we'll just punch 8 damage to the face, put some pressure on the zoo, and it's very important to be aware that most likely, apart from implosion, there's almost no way of clearing the ghoul without attacking it, right? So it's this ghoul is either eating an attack from a Doomguard or is an eating an attack from the Giant, which is awesome.
Yeah, either way, you're feeling pretty safe behind that ghoul.
Even if your opponent plays implosion, well, too bad. Those minions are getting killed after you play the implosion. So.
And what's a little bit crazy as well is this is potentially setting up lethal for Tice because he has the Grom next turn with the whirlwind effect from the weapon. Mm-hmm. So if this Shredder survives and there are no taunts or anything that go up, then this is just going to be game over. And you can see that Like a Boss doesn't really have too much to deal with this.
Well, he does have Knife Juggler, so he might try to get some juggles going, but he's not going for it. Also, an interesting fact is that Black Boss
can play the Gormok this turn to get the 4 damage to keep out the Shredder.
Yeah, that can work.
This is pretty nice.
An interesting thing though is that he's actually playing a mixture of a zoo where he is running Sea Giants, Bran, and Gormok in the same list.
Yeah, but we are going to see lethal. That's game.
Yeah, absolutely. This is 16.
Would have been really interesting though if that minion was one attack, then he would have been just short, right?
Yeah, but so then like you have how many outs do you have left in your deck? One inner rage. Well, he couldn't do it this turn, right?
So it just would have been a bit dicey because the actual other side of that board looked a bit scary with the giant still alive, the Gormok, the juggler.
One Defender of Argos would actually just set up a really good board for the zoo, so that was like one of the last turns to actually play into the play the aggressive route, right? Yeah. And Tice had to go for it, so that was a really nice play by Tice. The turn after the giant was played, just ignore the giant. This is when you recognize the situation of the board and you're like, yeah, let's do it, all in, boys.
Yeah, because it's pretty much like if he just didn't have a taunt, if the zoo player didn't have the another Argus and he'd already seen one, and like didn't have like an owl to silence the ghoul and then trade. Even so, like the odds on him having the enough damage to finish that game was so high that he set up that perfectly, exactly, at all, and then finished up.
If you go for the giant, that didn't feel good. Just attacking into it with the weapon, taking 8 damage, then losing your minion and not doing much afterwards. That wouldn't work that well. So a really good decision by Tice, and he got supported with that decision with that Shredder drop as well. I like about was close though. As Lothar said, Defender of Argus, or if Tice would get something that would not allow him to kill like a boss, then maybe on the back of another buff, maybe PO, maybe Doomguard. I'm not sure what he's playing.
Yeah, I think the thing is, like on that last turn, if the minion out with the Shredder, look at this board now. Like that's a lot of damage, and you still have Bran in hand and a juggler. So like, if he didn't kill him this turn. His turn would have looked very awkward because just two battle rages. Would you have had to run Grom into a minion maybe? You know, there's a lot that could have happened then, and like a boss could have took that game, but the Shredder drop being just about the right attack was really just finished the game up for Tyze there.
Tyze was playing Grim Patron Warrior but didn't get the Grim Patron, so he had to find underway to win and close the game.
All right, and now Tyze has to stay with the Grim Patron deck because he won his last Hero Standing format. Like a Baus cannot play his Zoo anymore. He needs to bring a different deck, and he's bringing his Control Warrior instead.
This is really interesting, actually. Control Warrior, or like standard Control Warrior, isn't like super common at the moment. And I'm just wondering already, is like a Baus gonna keep that Brawl? Because it's one of the cards that just answers the Grim Patron board. Like 9 times out of 10, leave one open and you can, as the Control Warrior, you have answers. You can probably deal with one last patron, so it'd be I'm really interested to see how he does this, because I think I would keep Brawl in this matchup straight, because he knows it's patron he's playing against and it has such a big impact. And obviously I'll just throw away the rest and try and get a weapon early on.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely correct. And this matchup should be good for like a Baus, because Control Warrior has so many ways to deal with what Patron Warrior is trying to do, especially now also without Warsong, where there's no way to charge with the minions. Patron is a bit more mid-rangey, but still, mid-range decks are fine for the Control Warrior. You do have the weapons, you have executes, you have a lot of removal.
Yeah, especially when the turns are very, very obvious. Like turn 5, if they have Deathbite already equipped, you're expecting Patron, so you can prepare for it. He did actually keep hold of the Brawl, which I like. And now he's got 2 Deathbites as well, and a Fiery War Axe. So he's got all the weapons he needs. But on Tyze's side, he also has Deathbite and Grim Patron, so just needs that inner rage to do the favored patron turn that we all know and love. But it would be answered by Brawl pretty quickly.
Yeah, that's why probably he might not go for it. So, Lothar, what do you think? When you're a patron player versus Control Warrior, do you just go for it and generate 4 to 6 patrons on turn 5, 6?
Well, I'm sure that Tyze was paying attention to the mulligan that Lycabos was making, and he saw that Lycabos kept one card. So he's now keeping track which cards are being used in the upcoming turns, and he will draw a conclusion from that. So an example, if the card will still not be used for the next 2-3 turns, so it's not Deathbite, because unless there's a second copy of Deathbite in his hand.
Yeah.
But most likely, if there's a Deathbite that will be played, that means the Deathbite wasn't kept in Lycabos's hand. And that's like the only thing, only card I think that would have been kept in Lycabos's opening hand, apart from Brawl. So in this particular matchup, I'm guessing that Tyze will know that there's a Brawl, but he might go for the patron anyway, just because that's his winning strategy. There's no other way you can win this match.
Well, Tyze doesn't know it's a Control Warrior.
No, he doesn't, not yet. And the problem is, though, as well, that if you don't go for patrons because you try and play around something like that, then you may as well not have patrons in your deck, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's like when you play against, some sort of more control wall locks, like Reno locks, where it's like, oh, should I do this? Because he could have Hellfire, and it's like, well, yeah, he could, but if you don't do it, then just take the cards out of your deck. Then, you know, I think you just have to go for it. And if it gets answered, fine. And you know a Brawl's gone. And if it doesn't get answered, then you know what? You're in a fantastic position.
I think what you can do is basically not overextend. Like, you can go for the patrons and create maybe 4 of them.
Yeah, you just do the standard, like, inner rage whirlwind if you can. And we see Tyze actually still not got the inner rage that he needs. But, you can go for it, or you can try and play a little bit slower. But this is... Lycabos is probably feeling pretty okay here. I don't really mind the Fiery War Axe, just to clean this up.
I think it's a big advantage.
Oh, he attacked, right? He attacked, yeah.
It's a big advantage that Tyze doesn't know this is the Control Warrior. For Lycabos, he can play his A game. He knows exactly what Tyze is playing. But Tyze, he will not know for some time. Unless he sees something like a Bash or Shield Slam.
It's a tough turn. Like, the Armorsmith just is okay. Doesn't really do too much, but, you know, it doesn't die to the minibot, so this is fine. Tyze doesn't look too happy about that draw. As the Frothing Berserker doesn't really do too much.
So do you go
that's
for the
other way. That's the other way of, like, baiting out the Brawl. If you build up the board with other creatures, right?
Yeah.
Then... This might be the other way of for Tyze to maybe win the game, because it doesn't look good on paper, that's what I can tell you. And It seems like Thijs will just use the weapon and set up the patrons next time because he has the whirlwind, right, for turn six.
Yeah, and as we were saying earlier, I think you just in this position, I think he just has to, right? You know, there's other than that, he's passing, and every time you pass versus Control Warrior, you just give them more and more time to be able to pull out those answers and just deal with your board.
Yeah, but then from Thijs' perspective, if he's playing versus patron, then just going with your patrons this turn is the best for you. Like, you really want to do it.
That will be definitely a turn of patrons.
But Thijs is not really happy about this turn overall. Like, he has some... it seems like maybe like a boss played the Control Warrior before, but he just has to go for it. The question is how much. All right, he goes like full into it.
Yeah, I think the problem is with the weapon equipped as well on like a boss's side, there is almost no point playing two. Like, if you're going to do it, make four, make it as awkward as possible for your opponent. And you know what? If he brawls and answers it, okay, good job. You know, like, and that's the way you have to approach matchups like this with big sweeps.
So let's look at Thijs' face. It's like, yep, okay. Now he knows this is the Control Warrior. Brawl is really unlikely to happen in the patron deck nowadays, at least.
It was a tech. It was when patron warrior was at the top of the food chain.
Yep.
Teching in a brawl in your own patron was like the anti meta.
Yeah, because so many people were bringing that deck.
The mirror match was just so important.
Yeah.
Thijs right. needs to get the second patron set. Without the second patron, this game was most likely to be closed in just two or three turns by the Control Warrior.
Well, he was able to deal some damage. Like a boss is at 18, and there might be a grom from Thijs as well, but I do agree that the second patron board would definitely push the game in Thijs' favor. For now, he just needs to draw cards. So that Battle Rage needs to be really good for Thijs overall. For Like a Boss, well, he has everything he needs, mostly.
The problem is that Thijs has 31 health and no damage. So it's like the one health above is just one armor. The perfect scenario would have been 29 damage
and
for
then
sure.
Armor.
Right? And then armor on top of it. This way, he can't really get the value from the battle rage, and he has no way of getting himself damaged because he has no weapon and there's no minion on the other side of the board.
And the thing is as well, even with his minions, we've already seen him use a whirlwind, so you know there's one effect you can use to actually just reduce the health of your own minions to try and get something from battle rage. It's an interesting turn though from like a boss, because there's like Dr. Booms always feels good there, but the board just kills the whole thing instantly, so that feels a little bit rough. So I kind of like the Sylvanas here. Makes like the trade a little bit awkward, and Thijs there just drawing into. I mean, Slam's okay to cycle, but it doesn't really accomplish too much.
Is this Thijs like forced to just go face overall? Like, it's always good to kill Sylvanas on your own terms, because if Sylvanas does not die, there's a huge chance she's just gonna steal your minion. But he is in a tight spot without many opportunities to draw.
Yeah, I wonder if like you just play Froth in. Maybe slam Sylvanas and then just go face.
What about just drawing cards? If you attack with Unstable Ghoul into Sylvanas.
The problem is then Sylvanas can trade with whatever minion it wants and like steal Froth in.
Yep.
Like that's what you want to try and avoid. Like I don't mind this. And yeah, you could even just play the Armorsmith now and just go face, I think.
Yeah.
Because Sylvanas, unless there's like a self-shield slam or something, Sylvanas can't kill itself this turn. Mm-hmm. So then you gain one more turn and you know the Froth in could build up from there.
Ooh.
Well, there is a weapon, so... Like a boss can attack into the Unstable Ghoul, then attack into Lothab and steal one of the minions.
Well, you need to kill the Infernal Berserk for sure if you're not stealing it. So what can you do this then? You can play Shields Maiden, you will have a Shield Slam for 5, you will have 1 mana for Execute left, which will trigger from the Unstable Ghoul attack. So let's say you can play Shields Maiden, Shield Slam the Ghoul, execute the Armorsmith, attack with the Lothab, into the Lothab with your Sylvanas. And this way you're stealing his Frothing Berserker, and your opponent has to play Execute, otherwise he's in a big steaming pile of gold.
That's right, he's gonna go in for the attack on the Ghoul. Let's see what the follow-up is. Do you think he's actually just happy stealing, like, Armorsmith?
I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, Execute should be fine here, just stealing
just steals the Ghoul.
Well, steals the Frothing.
The Ghoul. I didn't mean the Ghoul, I meant the Frothing.
It's a troll!
You know what I meant!
It's a troll!
You know what I meant! The guy with a lot of attack now.
I know it looks ugly, but come on. Do not be racist.
So this is kind of awkward for Tice.
It's terrible. He cannot draw cards with Battle Rage. It's a dead card. Good news for him, he had that execute, but right now he just needs to draw anything. Laika Boss can just start escaping from the range overall.
Yeah, I mean, the attack in and just slamming Dr. Boom feels... Oh, okay. He's going to save his weapon.
Well, the execute was just used, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I like it. He takes initiative, and so he's not playing super safe with Shield Maiden. He's just recognizing that there is no way to die from only two cards in hand. And for Tyus, it's still a really tough situation. Battle Rage not doing anything. Slam can draw him one card.
Well, he has an out. If he has a two-turn lethal, if Lycabos will not have a way of armoring up above two. So if he draws, of course, the Grommash, right?
Yeah.
He has a potential draw this turn. He's not using this turn? Interesting.
Yeah, I think the problem is with the Armorsmith on the board, it's very easy for him to armor up past
about.
Two.
Never
yeah.
mind, scratch that what I just said.
Because the odds on him just being able to play another minion, of course, and then attack in. So this is definitely looking rough for Tice. Like a boss, though, has all the options in the world now. And he's just playing super safe. He has Grom for damage. And he's just arming up to stop any sort of crazy shenanigans happening. The Dr. Boom just almost doesn't even need to be played in this game at the moment. He can just do another Shield Maiden next turn and just be so safe.
Suddenly, Battle Rage can actually work quite nicely. One card from Acolyte of Pain, two cards from Battle Rage.
That's quite unfortunate.
Yeah, do you have another execute left?
Yes, one execute is left.
Oh, Battle Rage again? Okay.
All right, filling out his
hand.
He's
still in a rage for an execute.
One more card. Come on.
The problem is that never feels good because then the Acolyte just dies to the Whirlwind effect next turn. If you don't draw execute as well, that's some problems. So definitely a tough one.
Also, you have in a rage for a patron, possibly.
Yeah. Patrons might just be too slow, though. If you don't draw the answer to this Grom, it's just going to be game anyway.
Well, he's drawing two cards next turn at least, right? Because he has Acolyte of Bane.
That's another answer to the patrons.
Yeah, quite good, especially when activated.
Yeah, feels he's on enough health now, so there goes Dr. Boom. And I will be very impressed if Tyson can come out of this.
I don't see a way, to be honest.
No. It's, I mean, Grom appears at last, and even there's an execute, but it's just not, it's too little too late now. We need the execute like 4 turns ago, maybe 3 turns. All that Grom in a rage could have actually finished the game if it was drawn a little bit earlier on.
It dealt 20 damage already. 20 damage from one card. That's quite a huge...
Not bad.
Huge amount.
That's
right?
A good card. Alright, so Dice is just looking at his options, but there is no way to come back, especially with what we see in hand for like a Baus. Shield Maiden, Revenge, just clearing the board, doing 3 damage to everything. He's still trying to look for options. It's never good to concede too early.
This control war is actually really interesting, Last Hero Standing, because if you look at Tice's lineup, we're sort of half presuming, of course, that the Warlock is still Zoo and the Paladin Secrets, right?
Yeah.
So I think Control Warrior actually does pretty okay versus those decks.
Well, Zoo is actually quite good versus Control Warrior.
I think it's okay.
Yeah, but it's like... If we
saying
talk
like I don't
right.
I don't think they're bad matchups, put it that way. Like I think they're okay for the controller.
Well, like about sizes it up, it's 1-1, and the control warrior will stay for the next game, right? And Tice probably will pick the zoo, right?
If that's a zoo, because Tice like is playing all kinds of warlocks, so he might have changed the lineup and
yeah, we saw Zoo from him yesterday, but like you said, they have these guys can change the decks for today, so they've already submitted them, of course. Mm-hmm. But he could well have switched to something else.
Absolutely. I don't know if he did, and Ilothar, if you know, probably it's good not to tell everybody what the deck is.
Well, we'll just see in a few seconds.
Yeah. But then like I do agree with you, Ilothar, with what you said before, that if he just went 5-0 with that lineup, is there really a reason to change it? Like a boss could probably study this lineup that Tice brought, so maybe mixing things up. Tice could be ahead of the curve a bit. For example, He brought the lineup A to the Swiss part. Then Lycabouse tries to counter that with lineup B. So Thijs is bringing lineup C to counter what Lycabouse can probably.
Yeah, this is where we see Thijs pull out like Hanlock and Murloc Paladin or something like that. Just to be like, I'm just going to throw you all off here and just take a super janky decks.
Well, I would assume that Lycabouse didn't go for the counter because he's playing Druid and Warrior, which might be falling short to a Zeus strategy and Paladin strategy, right? Like the Druid needs the swipes, needs the keepers, needs the innervates to have a good way of clearing the minions from both of those board-oriented decks. That's about it. So I think Lycabouse just stick to his guns.
Maybe he just went even deeper and was like, all right, so Thijs will think I'll change my lineup to counter his old lineup. So he'll bring this lineup. So I'll actually counter his new lineup that he's bringing.
Too much.
that's a problem usually that you face in huge tournaments. Because it's like, do I play with the best deck? Or do I play the counter? Or do I play the counter to the counter? Usually the third option is horrible.
Yeah.
Usually you just go 0-7 in the Swiss tournament.
You just mind games yourself out of the tournament.
Why did I pick that? And then you do the same next tournament. Like, okay, that was last time. And
all right, so Thijs is bringing the Zoo. We're not sure if this is exactly the same build, but this is definitely the Zoo deck again. And Contra Warrior. So Raven, you said this matchup is not a bad matchup for Contra Warrior.
Yeah, I think I don't think it's terrible. I think it's just okay. You know, but I think the Zoo's definitely, you know, not unfavored either. I think the Zoo can do really well against it, but I think there could be worse matchups for Lycabouse to have.
From my perspective, I would say Zoo is favored in this matchup specifically. It's interesting because against Patron is favored versus Zoo. I'll say Zoo's favorite versus Contra Warrior. And that's because Zoo has a lot of sticky minions. So you might get Fire War Axe, but there's Haunted Creeper, which doesn't really die. There's Nerubian Egg. So there's a lot of things that really stay on board. And your best tools to deal with huge boards from the aggro deck are tools like Brawl. Zoo can just replenish so fast with the hero power. So that's why I would give a slight edge to Zoo, but I agree with you in the way that it depends what people draw. So sometimes Warrior can just...
Yeah, I mean, in terms of Lycabouse's lineup, it could be worse. He could be on Druid at the moment, you know, versus the Zoo, which is, I feel, a much worse.
Yeah, I do agree as well.
He's actually got an okay start with the Fire War Axe. Even a low attack shield slam can do some work early on because you just want to keep the board clear. Not sure how much of an impact that True Heart's going to have. Sometimes it wins games like this if you can just stabilize for a turn or so, because then the armor just becomes too much for the Zoo to deal with. But yeah, the Fire War Axe, the Armor Smith, and the Shield Slam is definitely a good opening.
There are also interesting cards. So Lothar, we've seen Revenge. How much of an impact Revenge has in this matchup from the Contra Warrior perspective?
Huge impact, because it will most likely kill almost every single minion on the board if Thijs will not be careful about the health totals of the warrior, right? Because he can set up a lethal from an example from 15 or 17 just by building up the board and not seeing Brawl against it, right? It's very similar to the way that Zoo was playing against Handlock. We're just like, I'm not gonna attack this turn, I'm just setting up the POs for the next turn and burst it down with a massive swing. But the thing is, Thijs didn't see the Revenge. And he might not be aware that there's one. People are still sticking to the Whirlwind, Whirlwind card, because it's for one mana, which is a huge difference, because it can be always filling up the curve.
You can just fit it in, right? You know, exactly. You've almost always got just one mana spare to clear the board. And sometimes Revenge does what Whirlwind does, but for two mana, so obviously it makes it a bit less attractive. But yeah, like you said, Thijs didn't actually see it. And I think people are still kind of surprised when they see Revenge in Control Warrior. It's becoming more and more common, so it shouldn't be too much of a surprise, but I think people are still like, okay. They don't really think about the health total against Warrior. It's much more likely to do it against something like Warlock.
I was talking about Revenge to Stan Sivka, and he said that most of the time Warrior is floating mana, because it's not about being super efficient on curve. It's more about being efficient with your removal cards.
Yep.
So Revenge doesn't make much difference with regards to the early game, where you'd cast Whirlwind. You can cast Revenge, it's the same. you're just not floating mana there. And it's a huge difference, as Lothar mentioned, when you actually deal 3 damage to the whole board. We haven't seen Bash, though, overall, from Warrior yet.
Yeah. But yeah, you're completely right. The thing about Revenge is, like, you don't care about your mana, you care about clearing the board, right? So as long as that happens, you're pretty okay with it. This is a really interesting pick, actually. Kind of a tough one.
Yeah, there's no perfect answer here. You would like to have an Abusive Surgeon to kill the Acolyte of Pain, but now the target changes and he needs Abusive Surgeon for him top of the deck. Wait for the draw! Nope.
Yeah, and the problem as well is, like, the Jouster against Control Warrior when you're playing...
That's probably not gonna work.
Yeah, might not have the highest odds of winning
that. Well, you have two Giants, right? Or one Giant in
that's true,
deck,
yeah, that's true.
Which is 10 mana. But
ooh. Oh, Geddon's pretty huge as well.
Now, do you want to play the Pick'em Hunter? Because you're aware that your opponent will probably be playing Sea Giant, so you will keep that in mind.
Yeah. I wouldn't even mind the Slam here.
On the 3-2?
Yeah, just to get it off the board. And so the idea here as well is he's on quite a good amount of health on 29 at this point, which is pretty decent. And the longer the game goes on, the longer he's getting to cards like Geddon, which can just wipe the majority of a board and you know stuff like that. So you do just want to survive as the Warrior here, and he still has that shield slamming. Wow.
Yep,
I mean, do you just take PO, right?
No.
Really, Seeker is not that bad, actually. If you... Well,
it's
horrible.
It's scary because of Brawl, right?
If the Brawl would be there, then the Reliquary Seeker is just awful.
Yeah. I just kind of like PO because it's just good.
Yeah, PO is flexible. It's either Burst or it's removal card. So probably. But the Seeker is tempting, especially because you almost have a full board.
Well, you can
have you just play the Squire or
the
Egg.
Sacrifice your own Hunted Creeper.
Yep.
Then you
he's actually going for it.
No, he's not going. He's going for the next thing. So he plays directly into Brawl, but he's like, well, I guess if he has Brawl, I will lose anyway. So you either have it right now and you give me 3 minions, right? Because I will have a Nerubian Spider and 2 Spectre Spiders from Deathrattle. So then I can play Low Tap into Reliquary Seeker for next thing.
That won't block the Brawl.
It won't be enough.
Yeah, I know it won't be enough, but probably you won't be able to.
Yeah, at any point. You can just refill the board next turn on curve.
Yeah. Well, it looks pretty good. Like, if you play 2 5/5s on 6, but if there's no minion being played, he'll not have space for that.
So this is kind of rough, actually, because what I was thinking about is if he could get 4 armor, then, like, I wouldn't even mind, like, double shield slam on the egg just to remove that as a threat, because Brawl just doesn't matter anymore. He doesn't have it, of course, but if he draws it, Brawl just looks awful here. It'll be interesting to see if he thinks he can just leave the egg. Whoa.
Ooh, he's filling up the board, so no minion can be played. A very nice play.
Yeah, that's actually pretty cool.
That was smart. It's just bringing one more power to the board instead of something being played that can be, like, 5.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, this is actually a really good play because this isn't actually representing a lot of damage on the board, especially for a control warrior. Like, and now look at, you know, he's probably building towards that Geddon turn, I guess.
Absolutely.
Oh,
there is
a
Brawl.
There's a Brawl.
And he can even. Oh, no, he can't shield slam.
He doesn't have the armor. That was my initial thought, too, but I was like,
I want to get rid of the deck, right? Oh, Warrior.
This is so tricky.
But do you even Brawl this board? Like, you have Geddon next turn that can deal with most of it.
But what do you do this turn? You just play Jessicar, which can be traded with 3 minions. You don't get value from the Brawl, and you don't get value from the Baron Geddon next turn.
So you can just armor up and pass?
What about... So, this is... What about either Shield Slam or Execute on the 2-1? Let them play one more minion?
But what if that's Lothar?
Yeah, all right. We know it's Lothar.
I mean,
but I'm just saying, like, you maybe want to drag out one more big minion, hopefully, to, like, Brawl into. It's just tough because playing Justicar gets your hero power active for stronger, but like you said, it just instantly dies to 1/1s and frees up the board space that you've actually blocked out. So that was a really tough turn, actually.
I think Justicar is fine in the way that you will Brawl next turn and you can still armor up, and you start arming up from the next turn. Unless Lothab, obviously, which we're probably going to see.
You will see a 5/5 and a Lothab this turn.
Yeah.
Wow, 1 mana 5/5. Talk about balance.
OP. Imagine if Bram was down.
You like a boss win.
This is so sick.
Oh man.
9/9 for one mana. Seems good.
Yep.
So no brawl this turn. He can armor up though to get up to 20.
And the Baron Geddon doesn't look good. Because it decreases the damage by 4 and adds 4. So
yeah, you cannot Baron Geddon there.
Right.
So there's 10, 12, 13, 15. So there's 20 damage.
Gets.
Yeah, and he's actually off now because he's actually one mana off doing a shield. Like, Shield Slam would be okay to at least remove something. But yeah, that's actually.
Is he dead?
Oh, no, the bot's full, right?
Wait. No, but he can sacrifice one minion. But now the PO, that's lethal for sure. Because you just clear one of your minions. You have the space to play Doomguard. So you play the PO first.
Without the PO, he would have been one off, right?
It's 23 at the moment.
Well,
and it's 21.
15 to 22.
22?
Yep.
All right.
Did he actually need that PO for lethal that turn? Because he had 20, I think,
but he had to attack in. He needed that.
That's
that
crazy.
PO.
Wow.
Really right. Good play from both players though. Like, I like Lycabos's play to just felt like let the board be full of low minions, but that Lotheb, I think, actually just sealed the deal there.
I think he should have stick to his first idea of clogging the board, right? Because as we talked about the turn 6, actually the Justicar was allowing Tice to build up the board again, right? Because the initial photo for Lycabos was like, yeah, we'll just give him a lot of small minions that are not dealing enough damage to kill me, and that's fine, because the only way that your opponent will make some space on the board is by using a Mortal Coil, and usually the zoo players are not running those, and we could have seen that Tice needed the Mortal Coil from the Peddler, right? So maybe that was the choice. The turn 6 was just armor up pass.
But the problem was that if you armor up pass in 6, you just go down to 15 or something, and then your Geddon is not that good anymore, because with Geddon you just take 2 damage and you get the spider. So you're getting lower and lower. And also, if you go with the Justicar, you will be able to armor up with the Brawl. So you really hope there is nothing like Lotha being played. And then after that, you armor up, you Brawl, and then after that, you can Geddon and Brawl. So, like Geddon and armor up. So I think the decision was really tough there. It's really hard to say which one was correct, but like, seeing Lotheb, probably just armor up would maybe put him in a better position there.
Yeah, it was definitely a tough turn because, as you said, like, the longer you wait, the more damage you're taking overall, and because his armor was only for 2 at the time, it's definitely rough because you didn't really have the options that were good enough to follow that up with either, because Geddon just on 7 like would have caused some issues for him, obviously, that we saw.
Yeah.
But then you have to suddenly wait like till turn 10 to like Geddon armor up Shield Slam something, maybe like Shield Slam to just to reduce some the board down. So really tough decision there, but pretty good play from Tice.
I think that, yeah, exactly. Like, the key was Tice taking the Reliquary Seeker and being able to use it with Lotheb in tandem, which just put 10 power on board and sealed the spells. Okay, so Zoo versus Druid. This means that Tice is in a very good position, matchup-wise, again.
Unless they're going to innovate for the Keeper, because that's the MVP of the...
Oof.
Oof. Starting with Living Roots as well.
Yeah, so Living Roots into Innovate Keeper seems pretty reasonable.
But Tice has still a really good opening with the Flame Imp and Knife Juggler, and...
I think you just played Dark Peddler this turn.
Why?
It's a 2-2 minion. Your opponent will be pushed to use a hero power or sacrifice both 1/1s. And it gives you more options for the upcoming turns. You can play, like, turn 3 will be Knife Juggler into 1/1 minion. You have a lot of options to get a draw to fill out the curve, so not sure about this.
Well, Flame Imp had a similar effect overall, because you still expected your opponent to just attack with the hero power and one of the trains, and right now you have an opportunity to coin Imp Gangboss, or you would have it if not for the Keeper.
Yeah, it's interesting. You could play Juggler into the Voidwalker, but it doesn't quite do enough, so I really like the Gangboss here, and then you can follow up with like Juggler, Voidwalker, trade Gangboss to go for another Juggler as well, so that's pretty nice. But like a boss drawing into Force of Nature, actually, for the later turns is actually pretty strong, just to clear up some of the minions off the board from the Zoo player.
Yeah, even though he's missing this turn more or less, he still has a really good follow-up with turn 4, 5, 6.
Yep.
Now, where did Juggle go? I guess Thijs might be thinking about even attacking with the 2-2 into the keeper. Just to be sure that you can clear the keeper. Because of the 25% chances of not going into that.
Yeah, that's absolutely.
I kind of like seeing where the first juggle goes, because you might want to put the 2-2 into the 1-1 and just clear the 1-1s off and be happy at that.
Yeah, because the 2-1 will actually die to the Void Walker. That's so they can either attack into the 2-2 now and see where the juggle goes, or go with the Void Walker and it hits the 2-1, then you just attack the 1-1 and you are in a better position. Like, the second juggle can kill the...
Because you want one more imp from the gang boss, right? Yeah, I like this. Yeah. Like, this is really good, because you just get more value from the gang boss as opposed to just trading it into 2-2. And now the 2-1 dies to the Void Walker, which is nice, but also this forces out either a hero power or a wrath or something. So, you know, we can tell it's not going to happen, so now the Keeper of the Grove is sort of, you know, a bit moot at the moment.
Yeah, so Thijs is actually coming back with a nice board, and he still has the Knife Juggler that's unanswered. And even though this opening looked really well, Thijs is slowly taking control over this game.
Ooh. Is that worth...
Well, you can fill out the curve. With you see Dark Peddler first. Is there any card that would change? Like, Abusive Surgeon might change his mind, right?
Oh, another Void Walker is nice. Bad.
Yeah. I mean, either Soulfire or Void Walker. Soulfire will help against Azure Drakes, will help against Druid of the Claws.
Yeah.
And the problem is, just need to wait for turn 6 to use that card, right?
Yeah.
Because if you will get the Void Walker, you can use it this turn. If you get the Soulfire, it's a card for turn 6 because you want to play the low tap on 5.
Yeah. Well, you don't have to use the Void Walker this turn, actually. I'm still liking Iron Bigala to silence and clear the minion. Because Druid will...
Yeah, I like it now that Juggle's hit as well. So it means you can just run a... If there's other Juggle hits, yeah, you can just run the 1-1. Wow. That's insane.
Yeah.
So now he just plays off the Shredder. So, you know, completely destroys any tempo the Druid was going to get from that Shredder. And this is looking pretty rough. Even with the Living Roots draw, it's going to be hard.
What Thijs can do now is basically just always try to clear the board from the Druid and sneak in the damage, which is the best strategy that Zoo can have. And like a boss, will have to draw something like a swipe or find a way to deal with this board. Force of Nature will be quite good overall if he's able to go for the Void Walker.
Yeah, but the low tip will swing the board again, the same we saw it against the Warrior. It will have the same impact against this Druid. And Druid is even in a worse position. Because what are the ways of clearing the board? It's Force of Nature and double swipe. Yeah. That's about it.
I think it's going to be interesting next turn, though, depending on what comes down from like a boss this turn. If the Druid of the Claw gets played, he's actually got a really good power overwhelming on the Owl to just clear it straight up and then tap into potentially something else. But the Lotheb does go down, so it's probably going to be answered by another Lotheb.
Well, you have to play the Lotheb, because that's the thing that we discussed yesterday. Lotheb has an immediate effect on the hand, not on the board, right? So if you want to have maximum possibilities next turn, you have to attack with the low tap. The low tap doesn't have a charge, so you need something that takes the advantage of being played on the board right now.
And this means Thijs has 6 plus 8, 14 damage, which basically is it. It's game.
Yep.
Oh, wow.
The power of Dark Peddler again, guys. Like, the card is insane.
Abusive Surgeon? Nope. Like, the Abusive Surgeon would have been completely insane this turn. You would have plus 4 attack from Abusive Surgeon with the Bronn. Then you have 2 mana left. 40 PO and for the Soulfire, which is basically 12 damage from hand for 6 mana.
Yeah.
Not needed, because he had it in the hand, but again...
You've got to go for the overkill when it's available.
Yeah. Just like for the BM, or just to make like a boss. You kill him so hard that you even take the $500 here.
Yeah.
I mean, that just shows the power of Rizu when it's being built with consistent cards, right? You don't have Encanto Meccano or other cards that just... So that they can be super consistent, and that's something that was always the power of Zoo.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Hi, Thijs.
Congratulations. Hello. Congratulations, Thijs. You advanced to the top 8. You actually guarantee yourself $1,000. And 2 HCT points.
Oh, yeah. That's amazing.
that's pretty impressive. And again, you did it again with the Zoo. I mean, you did win with the Warrior before, but this Zoo deck is really carrying you this tournament.
Yes, but I also pick it a bit for the right matchups. And I have to say, the zoo games that I have here on stream, in my other matches, my other two decks are actually performing really good, and zoo does decent. But yeah, it's I think it's just really strong when everybody, you saw the druid had an amazing start, but it can also outvalue the druid if they have a fast start. So
and that's true.
Yeah, but I have to say, it's not an easy deck. I have so much trouble playing zoo. It's of course, you can play it okay, but playing it 100% correctly, like mulligans are so hard with zoo.
That's yeah, true. I do agree. This is something like Strife Crew used to say as well, like zoo is too hard for me. Mm. Like he was basically saying that sometimes. Because it seems like it's super easy where you just get the dudes, you play the dudes and you attack face. But the place you did, like the fact that you took Reliquary Seeker and you were able to pair it with Lotheb and the cards you... Like right now it's even more difficult, I think, with Dark Peddler as well.
Yeah, Peddler is a really interesting card. And I really like the Seeker because I was like, yeah, I only have to play around Brawl. And I don't even want to PO my egg at all. I just want to have a 0/2 egg on the board. So
Good call up, because there might be always a clear with Barangeddon, with a Brawl, or the Revenge, or like double Whirlwind effect because of the Death Rattle of Death Spider and a Whirlwind, right? So there's a lot of options.
The first time when you play versus Warrior, did you expect a Control Warrior or Patron?
I expected, I wasn't sure, but I expected Control Warrior a bit. It made a bit sense of a lineup. Patron also made some sense. But when he picked the Warrior into my Warrior, I was super sure. Because that was the matchup he wanted with his druid if it was Patron. So when I get into the matchup Warrior against Warrior, I was sure. And
yeah, it's not often you actually want to play the Patron mirror. For example, it seems it's very, very swingy.
Yeah, but it was also the best matchup for his druid against my lineup. You don't really want to pick it into Paladin or
that's
druid.
True, yeah.
So then at that moment, I was sure. But yeah, you just have to go all in. It's such a terrible matchup. You just have to hope, and you hope that they don't have all the weapons and no brawl. And yeah.
And he had a brawl and for you weapons.
Yeah. So well. But that was fine. Patron did the job. It won a game.
Yep.
And then it lost the game. Well,
it's okay.
Yeah.
All right. Raven, any questions to Dice?
No, just a good set overall. I think what you were saying earlier about the way, you know, Zoo looks good because you're picking it into the matchups just sort of displays the difference between Last Hero Standing and Conquest. Because, like, you know, having the knowledge of what deck you're going up against, like, just influence your choices so much.
All right, Thais, we'll have you casting with us as well if you're willing to, and the future matches. Right now, you can just rest and chill overall, because for today, that's basically it. You will play tomorrow, so congratulations again. And guys, any questions to Thais?
Not Lothar? Really. You will have him tomorrow again playing. So we'll see how that goes.
Hopefully, fingers crossed. All right, so guys, that was the first match for today. Thais versus Lycabaus. Thais winning it in a really cool fashion. We'll have much more Hearthstone for you today because we have still 7 more matches. We're deciding the full top 8. So stay with us. But for now, we need to prepare the next match. So we are going into short break. Stay tuned.